Sinon Valadino Cornelis, with insights into biogeography and diversification. And as you all know, that the Cornelis represent the earliest branch of the living asterisk clade in the endosperm tree of life. And so understanding the histories of the group would be helpful for a better understanding of the evolution of the asterisk clade. And the Cornelis consist of several small families and three relatively larger families, and morphologically are quite heterogeneous. And many of these small families are restricted in their present distribution to one or two regions, like Eastern Asia, Eastern North America, in China, Eastern Asia, Southern Africa, and then three are more widespread. And however, most of these families that are presently restricted in geographic distribution have fossils occurring outside of the present distribution. And this is the summary of the fossil information of Cornelis, which may not be complete. And many of these actually are known only by fossils, as indicated in the blue dots. And several of these new fossils are reported recently. They're dated back to the late Cretaceous. And just to give you a few flashing view of the examples, like Alandriaceae, here is the distribution of the fossils throughout the tertiary time, and the current distribution only in the Old World tropics. And then the Nisois, current distribution in Eastern Asia, Eastern North America, and fossils are occurring in Asia, Europe, and Western North America, and as old as late Cretaceous. And Mastixia, current distribution Southeastern Asia, and fossils in Europe and North America. And then Southern African lineages have fossils in Europe and Mexico, late Cretaceous. And then several lineages of the dogwoods restricted to Eastern Asia, Eastern Western North America, and some in Europe and Africa. And then all these lineages have fossils in Europe. And then also fossils in North America, and as old as the late Cretaceous. So the striking abundance of Cornelian fossils suggests that by the end of Cretaceous, the order had already diversified, well diversified. And so we wanted to gain a good understanding of the evolution history of the group with the fossil data and as well with genome-wide data from the corpus genome, and to see through this analysis and to see if there's if the molecular evidence corroborate with the fossil evidence, and to understand how fossils impact the understanding of biogeographic history analysis in the group. And so we assembled 81 plastic genomes from all the team families of the group, and representing actually all the genera of every family except for Loassaceae, for which we don't have access of materials. And then we assembled the genome data from the genome skimming data, and constructed different set of molecular data to infer phylogeny and to assess how coding positions and synonym substitution may have affected inference of phylogenetic study. And so this represents the protein coding sequences, and then third position of the sequences, and then first and second coding positions of the protein coding sequences, and then degeneracy coding method of the sequences, and amino acids and non-coding sequences, and all six data metrics. And then we estimate average time, CD2 method, and diversification rate with Medusa, and then biogeographic inferences using DEC method in three different ways. And first, without including fossil information, and then including fossil distributions to the living species, and then connect the fossil lineages to dated phylogeny. And so I'm going to just talk about the results. And here are the trees between the amino acids and the nucleobase, concatenate nucleobase trees. And in general, and the phylogenetic relationships of the families within the order are well resolved and completely resolved, and strongly supported, almost identical to the previous seven corpus DNA gene based phylogeny. And I just want to point out here that surprisingly, again, these soils, mastic-soil clays, grouping with the Hydrangeaceae, Lauraceae, and Hydrostachyaceae clay, rather than with the traditional conoid clay. And then there's also conflict placement for the Hydrostachyaceae, the aquatic plants from southern Africa, and the nucleotide-based phylogeny suggests alignment of the family with the Lauraceae only, and then the amino acids supported the alignment with both Hydrangeaceae and Lauraceae. And so what is the problem here? And so we explored the data sets, and then we found that the alignment of Hydrostachyaceae, which is usually have a long branch, associated with Lauraceae in these two data sets, third codon position and then the concatenate nucleotide sequences of protein coding genes. And then the rest of the data set all supported alignment of Hydrostachyaceae with Lauraceae Hydrangeaceae, and the same as the previous cell gene based phylogeny. So this suggests that the third codon position could be the problem leading to the conflict. And so we did not actually detect any substitutional saturation or codon usage bias in the data set, but we do find the GC content is lower in the Hydrostachyaceae, which probably the compositional heterogeneity explain the problem of the third codon position through the synonym substitution and cause this conflict. So this is the dated phylogeny that was calibrated with 8 fossils, and the result from the two methods are very similar, and then they both suggested middle Cretaceous origin of the crown groove of the Cornelis, followed by rapid radiation into several major lineages, indicated by the red arrows, within the window of about 10 million time, and as indicated by these different colors of the major lineages. And so then by the late Cretaceous time, and all the crown node of the present families have evolved. And so this is consistent with the prediction from the fossil data. And so this slide shows the exact numbers of the divergence times, the value of divergence times of the major divergence events in the Cornelis, the earliest evolutionary history events. And the two methods provide very similar estimate for those ages. And the result from Medusa found an increase of net diversification rate in the Hydrangeaceae, Lauraceae clade, indicated here, and then another dramatic increase of the net diversification rate in the Ferrodelphus lineage, and then a decrease of rate in the Cretaceous Gruvia lineage, and then another decrease in the Fendalera gemmacea, subfamily Gemmosoidea of Hydrangeaceae in here. And this result makes sense because these groups are the most very species rich, and then these two lineages are very species poor, have only 4 or 3 species in the clade. So biogeographic inferences without including fossils suggested that the ancestral distribution of the order is most likely of Asia and Africa, and then the ancestral distribution of the crown node of all the different families are indicated in green, as you can see, Asia, Africa, Asia and North America, Asia and North America here. And then the formation of these families involved some early recurrence events, extinction events, and then dispersal events, and then another recurrence events during the middle Cretaceous time. But in contrast, when you include fossils, the two analyses with fossil information resulted in results of distributions very similar. And so I presented one of them here, and also both suggested a very wide distribution of the ancestral range of the Cornelis, including Asia, North America, Europe, and Africa. And then the, however, you will see, also you will see that the ancestral distribution of each of the living families are quite different from the one we thought, including fossil information, as I showed you earlier. And that clearly indicating the important and critical role of including fossils to understand biogeography in this group. And so the evolution of these different families involve different events of extension and recurrence, and then dispersal and extension and dispersal. And so the history is somewhat distinct from the inference from analysis without using fossil information. And by the way, this analysis did not include the recently found Rubiaceae fossil, in Mexico. So if Mexico included in the analysis, we probably changed the note here to be North America and Africa, and then the extension in Africa, the extension in Europe will be onto the stem lineage of the Rubiaceae. Yes. So, and this early history actually is consistent with the Earth's history. And then in the Middle Cretaceous, the Laurasian land was not well separated. And then the distribution of the Cornelian fossils also supported a radiation and consistent with, corroborate with a wide distribution of the ancestors across the Laurasian land as well as Africa. And then the studies suggested the frequent exchanges between the Laurasian and then Africa during those time of the Earth. And so the exchange usually occurred through the Mediterranean Tethys Seal, and which is a discontinuous route that connected southern Southeast Europe to Africa, and was controlled by the sea level changes. And so the interchanges between the two areas mostly going through southwestern Europe and then Africa during the Cretaceous time. And so in conclusion, we found evidence supporting a mid-Cretaceous origin of the order in the Trans-Tethys region, followed by rapid radiation into major lineages, and then involving repeated extension by currents and dispersal events across the Tethys seaways for the order. The molecular evidence corroborate with the fossils, indicating, suggesting this hypothesis. And then we also found that third codon positions in the plastic genome could be problematic in inference of phylogenetic relationship of lineages with accelerated evolutionary rate. And then the final point I want to make is that the paraphyly of the Cornoids group found in the corpus in the genome phylogeny suggests that the shared fruit morphology that uniting the Cornoid lineages could be either independent origin or plesiomorphy, right? So we really need the nuclear phylogeny to test the hypothesis. So go to this talk on Wednesday, you will find the story about Cornelius becomes more interesting. with that, I will thank my collaborators and co-authors and then for their support. And thank you for your attention and for being here. And with that, if I have time to answer a question.
Okay, thanks, Jenny. Well, I'm afraid in the future time we have to move on.